रेडी सपना। हेलो एवरीवन एंड वेलकम टू दिस वेबिनार एंड द मीडिया वर्कशॉप दैट्स ऑनलाइन ऑन द स्टेट ऑफ clean mobility in India. We're very glad to have very well-known practitioners and researchers of the clean mobility space in our country to talk to us today. I'm absolutely sure that all of you will get lots of story ideas from what you hear today. And it's our effort to try to help you do those stories. While this online media workshop is going on, I shall share with all of you on the chat box a link to apply for story grants. Please remember that the deadline to apply for those grants is tomorrow. It's been up for quite some time, and now the deadline is tomorrow. That's the end of the month. So please do apply and please ask questions. We shall request all the speakers who have prepared presentations for you to share those presentations with us so that we in turn can share those presentations with you. Having said this, I would like to invite the moderator for today's workshop, Sapna Gopal, to take over the proceedings. Sapna, over to you. You're muted, by the way.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Yeah, okay. Hi, everybody, and very good morning, and very good morning to all our panelists and all our participants. And I guess Joydeep has given us a brief about the webinar and also about how you can register, and tomorrow's the last date for sending in your story ideas. And I will just give a very brief presentation on the clean mobility in India, and then the speakers will take over. So can this be seen? Share my screen. Okay. Yeah, so we are talking about clean mobility in India today, and today's webinar, the speakers will be speaking about the issues, the challenges, and the way ahead for this particular sector in India. So India has taken various initiatives, and it is trying various policy measures to steer the clean mobility sector. And interestingly, it's a participant country in the EV30 at 30 campaign, which is a clean energy ministerial initiative, and which aims at the sales share of EVs to reach 30% by 2030. There's also the National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020, which outlines the roadmap for faster adoption and manufacturing of EVs in India. And I think a lot of people know about this, that there is the Department of Heavy Industry, which formulated this particular program, which is more popularly known as FAME, which is actually the Faster Adoption and Manufacturing of Hybrid and EVs in India in 2015. Which intends to promote the sustainable growth of hybrid vehicle technologies. So India has taken measures, policy measures, to ensure that the clean mobility sector gets a go ahead. There is also electric vehicles are definitely the next big thing, because the targets for electrification in India include 30% of private vehicles, 70% of commercial vehicles, 40% of buses, which is very interesting, which is obviously they're looking at the public transport sector, and also 80% of two and three wheeler sales by 2030. And a lot of there have been a few brands which have also introduced a lot of electric two wheelers into the market now. There's also there's a push from the government to online retail companies to shift their delivery solutions to electric. And one of the best examples is Amazon has teamed up with Mahindra Electric for introduction of 10,000 EVs into its delivery fleet by 2025. So they are obviously looking at EVs in a big way going forward. And apart from the center, which has formulated the FAME program, the state governments themselves have taken a lot of initiatives. So Indian states, for instance, the state of Kerala offers incentives in the form of tax breaks, road tax exemptions, toll charge exemption, free permits for fleet drivers and free parking. In the state of Bihar, the subsidies which are provided to the tune of 12,000 rupees to the end user, and there's an additional special incentive of 10,000 rupees for lithium-ion battery e-rickshaws. Delhi, on the other hand, offers maximum incentive of 30,000 rupees per vehicle for scrapping and deregistering old and highly polluting two-wheelers. And many cities in India have also prepared the Comprehensive Mobility Plan, also known as CMP, independently or with the help of the union government. But then, despite all the initiatives that have been taken by the government, both at the center and the state level, there are some challenges that India as a country faces with regards to the e-mobility sector. One of the biggest challenges, according to experts, is the power availability. So because e-mobility, it is believed, will need additional power availability on existing grids, and India's current energy grid system will not be able to handle charging many EVs at the same time. So charging EVs is an issue, and a mere 30% EV addition in two-wheelers and four-wheelers will require 3 to 4% more power generation capacity than normal. There's also this issue of e-waste management, because the sheer volume of battery waste that will emerge will require an enhanced spatial provision in cities to handle that waste. So these are the couple of, there are many more challenges, but I have not included those in my presentation. I'm just touching upon it very briefly. And there is this graph, however, which is interesting and which shows the projected cumulative sales of EVs in India. So if we see that 2020, obviously the figure is not very, very encouraging probably, but going forward, and the numbers which have been given on the left side of the graph are in millions. So that shows how the EV sector, the sales of EV sector going ahead, by 2040 is a huge number. It's almost going beyond 360 million. So I think that shows that definitely there is a lot of scope for the growth of sale and growth of EVs in India. So this is a graph which has been sourced from electricvehicles.in. And also interestingly is that there has been a green vehicle rating which has been launched in India. So the Alliance for an Energy Efficient Economy, which is an organization that works on creating awareness about energy efficiency as a resource, has released the Green Vehicle Rating, or the GVR, which is apparently India's only vehicle rating system based on environmental performance. So we had green buildings earlier, then we had energy efficient appliances formulated by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, and now this is the Green Vehicle Rating in India. So this is essentially an information tool, and it aims to reshape consumer knowledge on vehicles and would also help buyers calculate its impact on a community's health and environment. So this in brief is the EV sector in India and a few of the issues and what is being done in terms of policy. We will now move on to our first speaker for today. And that is Vibhuti Garg, who is an energy economist, a Lead India Institute for Energy Economics and Financial Analysis. She will be speaking on the role of subsidies for pushing electric mobility and how rooftop solar and EVs are influencing the same, and what is the future going forward. So Vibhuti, over to you, and look forward to your presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Sapna. Am I? A very good morning, everyone. Let me just share my screen. Well, it is well established, you know, that electric vehicles can reduce toxic air pollution relative to conventional vehicles, and more importantly, you know, shift emissions out of cities with benefits for both livability as well as health. The benefits of electric vehicles, you know, will improve India's transition away from polluting coal-based electricity. In order to first that India shifts firstly to electric mobility, and secondly, that electric mobility is cheaper than coal-fired power plants. So the government of India, you know, has set a huge target of 40 gigawatt of installed rooftop solar capacity by 2022 to achieve various objectives, you know, from such as energy security, reduce land use strains, better strengthening of the national grid, and also to improve air quality as well as reduce consumer costs. The government has undertaken significant measures to support the adoption of electric vehicles and energy efficient appliances. We at IFA feel that going forward, you know, the future is rooftop solar plus storage, either in the form of batteries or electric vehicles. Rooftop solar, while continuing to improve in efficiency, is on its own, is kind of yesterday's technology. You know, we are seeing that with the drop in prices, there are large consumers, more C&I consumers, but even residential consumers, you know, kind of adopting this technology. But we feel that, you know, solar plus storage, with some form of storage, it's already there, but solar plus mobile storage, which is basically your electric vehicles, is what will be in the near term future. So today I'll just focus quickly and show what kind of subsidies or government programs that are benefiting electric vehicles versus conventional fuels in India, and how support to EVs has increased over the years, but still very, very minimal. So this slide just quickly gives you a snapshot of the kind of subsidies that were given through different government programs in financial year 2019. This is based on a study done by ISD and CW. In financial year 2019, the total government subsidies totaled 1.74 lakh crore. If you see in this graph that, you know, electricity subsidies have if you compare the subsidy distribution 5 years back versus now, it was oil and gas subsidies which were the largest recipient, but over the years, because of a lot of government programs, electricity, T&D sector is getting more and more subsidies. Coal subsidies have largely been around the same values over the years, while RE subsidies, you know, increase substantially from FY 2014 till 17, but then given that renewable energy became more and more competitive, the subsidies started falling down. Most interesting is what is the government support to electric vehicles. So these subsidies to electric vehicles are small but are gaining momentum. So clearly they have registered, you know, a substantial increase in terms of government support programs over the years. But if you will compare with subsidies to your conventional fuels such as oil and gas, coal, it is very, very minuscule. So Sapna has already touched upon, so I will not talk about the various government schemes that have been, that have led to increase in adoption of electric vehicles, and government has set up huge targets for electric vehicles, different targets for private cars, but more for public transport, which includes commercial vehicles, buses, and two and three wheeler sales by 2030. And to make EV adoption easier for manufacturers and consumers, the government of India has taken some various steps in the last few years. And the table below kind of provides a quantitative analysis, you know, or the subsidies that has been going to electric vehicles because of these government support measures. So if you will look at the table, clearly the two big schemes that have, supported electric vehicles are the concessional GST rates on electric two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And further, the FAME scheme, both FAME 1 and in fact, FAME 2 has, increased the allocation from the government, almost like 10 times. So from about 150 annual or around 400-450 crores that were given in the FAME 1 scheme, now the allocation is 10,000 crore for FAME 2, which will be from financial year 2020 to financial year 2022. Again, the support to EVs, as I was saying, while the number is very, very small, but compared to financial year 17 to financial year 19, the support has grown over 11 times. But Sapna did highlight some of the challenges as well. So policies should be monitored to ensure, effective, efficient and equitable support, including for two-wheelers, public transport, waste treatment, especially, and battery recycling. So support which the government has been giving and the kind of targets the government has set, it may not be sufficient to reach those 2030 targets. So more policy support and more other kind of incentives and policies need to be put in place for kind of achieving the kind of targets that the government has set out. In fact, a study was undertaken by Niti Aayog and Rocky Mountain Institute in 2019, and they estimated that FAME 2 could save 5 million tons of oil equivalent and 7 million tons of CO2 just through adoption of this FAME 2 schemes. But the full life cycle assessments based on the context in India is not there, which is required in order to understand the benefits. As well as the issues which relates to specifically, address the battery waste, which could be a big problem going forward. Further, we strongly feel that EVs can provide the required storage, the mobile storage that I mentioned at the beginning of my talk, and which can help manage variable renewables. So EVs combined with RTS is the future. This is quickly a snapshot of where the solar rooftop capacity is as of now, which is about 6.7 gigawatt as of December 2020, while government has set up huge targets of 40 gigawatts at the end of March 2022. Clearly, as I said, rooftop combined with either battery storage or stationary EVs, which is mobile storage, could be the game changer in the future. If they are used in conjunction because the kind of advantages it provides. So I'll just kind of talk about how now the rooftop plus EVs dynamics can play a big role. Especially the distributed generation of rooftop solar along with EVs will be the most disruptive technology going forward. And why it will make a difference and kind of the dynamics of energy markets that will play out clearly, firstly, because with rooftop solar, we can have generation and load on site, and with electric vehicles, we can have energy storage on wheel. So this will help the distribution companies to reduce the transmission and other retail costs. So beneficial for various stakeholders. Secondly, rooftop solar is already very cheap and is expected to have a gain in the next 3 years. So if optimized, the daytime charging cost of battery or EVs will be very low. Thirdly, EVs are the future of transportation. With this form of distributed mobile storage, it makes sense to have distributed charging co-located with generation. It will be a lot more costly for household or fleet managers to rely primarily on off-site public or private charging stations and to charge the vehicles using rooftop solar directly. Further, you know, EVs are mobile and are able to be driven to charge from different locations. And clearly with the kind of large batteries that now the EVs, are being put in the EVs. So mostly these new models have 6 to 10 times the capacity of small scale batteries. So definitely there is some upgradation on that end as well. And if they are charged with renewable energy, they will help rapidly to decarbonize the transport sector and reduce India's enormous and growing reliance on imported oil. Further, I think the other big advantage is that EVs also provide huge potential to provide vehicle-to-grid services, which includes relieving grid congestion and providing, you know, ancillary services such as frequency and voltage control. EVs can definitely both charge from and discharge into the grid. So this kind of service is quite beneficial. And as such, you know, there's potential to leverage private sector investments for public benefit if we get the right incentives, technical standards, and regulatory arrangements right. What is the way forward? So this potential of public transport and private vehicle fleets to provide relatively low cost means of providing flexibility. Given charging and discharging can be managed to make the most of rooftop solar availability, example on the roofs of bus or fleet charging stations. So this, they can provide a lot of flexibility. The outcome of thoughtfully combining RTS and EVs would be greater self-sufficiency for the households and C&I consumers if DISCOMs becomes suppliers of RTS plus EV offering with managed charging. They can earn revenue and also reduce the risk of unmanaged charging causing unnecessary cost to the grid. Further, I would say time of day tariffs would be critical in ensuring a good success of RTS plus EVs. So RTS is rooftop solar. So without time of day tariff, it is likely to result in solar exports during the day and potentially peak charging demand at other times. So this will increase overall cost and the burden to other consumers. So this should be avoided through introduction of time of day tariff. Lastly, DISCOMs could develop charging stations at the most appropriate locations in their grid and look to the potential of vehicle to grid to ease future grid congestion. So clearly, I would say there are huge benefits of combining rooftop with electric vehicles. I will stop here and happy to take any questions later. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Vibhuti, for that wonderful insight into how rooftop solar and EVs can be, together used to further the EV sector and clean mobility sector in India. We will take questions towards the end of the webinar. We will now move on to our next speaker, Mr. George Kutty Karyanapalli, who is the founder and MD of Life Solar, which has been involved in innovating and creating a lot of vehicles. Interestingly, what Vibhuti mentioned about solar. So Mr. George Kutty has been instrumental in creating a lot of vehicles which are powered by solar, and in the process, creating sustainable growth of not just EVs, but also of communities in Kerala, in Trivandrum, if I'm right. So Mr. George Kutty, over to you and over to what you have to tell us about how, encouraging carbon-free public transport system, how it is important at the grassroots level in India. So over to you, sir. So you will have to unmute yourself.
He has unmuted himself, but we can't hear him.
Sir, we cannot hear you. Can you please check your audio?
He has muted himself again.
Sir, can you unmute yourself, please? Yeah.
Sapna, shall we go to the next speaker while...
Yeah, I think we'll just move to the next speaker. Yeah. Sir, we'll just move to the next speaker.
Yeah, so...
So we'll move on to Dr. Shalini Sareen. Hello. Am I audible? So I think Mr. George Kuti is having some issues with his audio, so we'll come back to him later. We'll move to our next speaker, Dr. Shalini Sareen, who is the co-founder and executive director of Electromobilitat. And she will be interestingly addressing the topic of how to increase, how EV adoption can be increased in India, and what are the opportunities and the challenges that lie with the same. So Dr. Shalini, over to you, ma'am. Dr. Shalini? Dr. Shalini, can you hear me?
I think it's still muted. Can I unmute? Yes.
Sapna, you want to come back to Mr. George Kuti when his audio is fixed?
Hi, ma'am. We'll finish your presentation and your address, and then we will move to George Kuti. No, not a problem.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, am I audible?
Yes, you are, ma'am. Please go ahead.
So thank you very much, Sapna and Vibhuti. I think you've set the context very, very well. And first of all, before I start my discussion, I want to start by saying how pained I am at what is going on in India today and what we are facing as a country reels under the fierce new wave of COVID-19. And I understand the decision was not made lightly to continue with this talk, because as we look ahead and the pandemic subsides, we need to have a path to recovery from this COVID to take us back to our tasks. So I think currently we are all focusing on our energies to support, to reach out, to help. And the next step would be to revive and recoup and finally sustain and restore. Coming up back to the topic of discussion, where driving demand and adoption of clean energy is the topic that we are, you know, under our discussion. I think there are a lot of opportunities for us in India today, and there are a lot of challenges as well. We've all talked about the FAME scheme, which was launched in 2015, for not only adoption, but manufacturing. And that becomes extremely important because we need to reduce the reliance on other countries. And of course, there was a pledge taken in 2015 to reduce the carbon emission intensity by 35% by 2030. Besides the EV policy in various states, you've elaborated very well on, and I think there are a collective of 9 states which are doing very well in terms of launching their subsidies and policies to enhance the adoption. It is not going to be easy, and we've seen worldwide trends, and we need to be able to learn from them as well. The government has also proposed a 5-year program on to promote the development of plants for storage, large-scale manufacturing, integrated batteries, and cells in various phases. Again, that would reduce the dependence on our imports. The business model too is changing. So today, the EV manufacturers, traditionally, for example, Bajaj Auto makes scooters, but his job does not end by manufacturing and selling the scooters. He or, you know, even the car manufacturers like Tata, Mahindra, they also get involved in the charging infrastructure. In the past, this was not their headache. The fuel charging was the headache of the Shells and the HPs and the BPs. But today, the EV manufacturers are getting involved also in the infrastructure, on the charging side. And therefore, EV OEMs are setting up common development and technology platforms to ensure interoperabilities. And that becomes very important because each car has its own type of batteries. And unless we create that interoperability, we will not have effective charging and therefore not effective adoption, and therefore all the challenges will continue. There are, however, many barriers to slow uptake of EVs. One, lack of infrastructure. And we all know that it's a chicken and egg story. You know, you have to make the infrastructure viable. And this has resulted in customers being very hesitant to adopt EVs, though so many EVs have been launched this year and many planned for next year. There will be 17 EVs in these 2 years launched in India. Then vehicles availability, high cost of financing, lack of awareness regarding EVs and their benefits, and the total cost of ownership, you know, and these are significant barriers to adoption. There is also a need to let go of some controls by the government. So you would have seen in a lot of tenders that were floated, the government has been very stringent in specification. We all know that if they start specifying the chargers and the specifications, there is a huge, huge gap and erratic power supply that we have. So we have to be very pragmatic while specifying, because these stringent measures of having, you know, an AC type 2 or a DC charger of at that many kilowatts, all of that may sound good in terms of giving all options to the customer, but is that viable from the grid perspective is what we need to consider. And government may not be the most equipped in terms of all the technologies, and therefore this whole partnership that we have started where Delhi government is doing a great job, where I'm a great fan of Jasmine Shah, where a lot of engagements with all the ecosystem partners has been engaged, has been taken to take inputs and facilitated by RMI and Niti Aayog, of course, to ensure that we are able to provide the best ecosystem support. And it's poor, inefficient use to have, you know, chargers installed for only buses at bus depots, because buses usually do an overnight charging. So the whole day, those chargers will be idling. Or, for example, in one of the tenders, I see that they are trying to get chargers and infrastructure installed on highways. And we've learned from the world over that EVs do charging at highways has been the least utilized worldwide because of range anxiety, because of whatever. So it is always in the city and within a particular perimeter that EV uptake has been more successful rather than highways to begin with. And that may come, you know, much later. So some of my suggestions that could really make a difference are, one, we have to increase the awareness and buzz, and maybe have some, you know, call centers and hotlines which are only doing public outreach to educate the customer on the total cost of ownership, on EV awareness, on efforts to standardization and interoperability. And through the Switch Delhi campaign, we've done a significant amount of work through RWAs, corporate youths, and you know, other stakeholders to contribute towards the zero emission vehicles. But these outreach programs need to engage with policymakers and also be able to address some grievance redressal for platforms and resolve queries. Second, how can the public and private sectors work together? And we've seen world over where city municipalities, whether it is in the Nordics or in the Netherlands or wherever else, the uptake has been good, build public EV charging infrastructure and encourage the stakeholders to invest. So, you know, somebody has a small land or and today now, the land is provided by the government under the new tender that is being floated. So how do you get other people to engage and invest? Enable faster and cheaper registration for EVs, raise awareness of EV leasing schemes. Leasing as, for EV removes the consumer risk of uncertain resale value, battery degradation, and rapid technology advances. Then introduce regulation to ensure the electric tariffs at charge points are low, because that has to be affordable for the community. Target financial incentives for the low income buyers. Electrify school buses, that could be a low hanging fruit. Offer free public parking, priority parking. Consider offering free, off charge initially. Allow EV access to bus lanes to enable EV drivers to travel more quickly. Encourage innovative electric car sharing businesses. The third one is encourage startups. And we have seen the investment in startups has really, really grown from 2017, from $20 million to $400 million in 2019. And some of the startups which have done very well are Ola Electric Mobility, Arthur Energy, Ampere, 22K, KYMCO, Eon Energy, and some of the prominent fleet operators like Blue Smart, 22 Motors, Lithium Cabs, Yulu, Zip, and Smarty. The success of low maintenance homegrown e-rickshaws has also done very well. You know, we've seen Kinetic Green, Mahindras, they've been an inspiration. And India's fleet of battery-operated three-wheelers have expanded from a 4,000 strong in 2010 to 1.5 million within less than a decade. So we've seen about 11,000 electric rickshaws add in every month, and that's reported by A.T. Kearney. The fourth one is mitigate range anxiety, and we've all talked about it. So therefore, I think this is very, very important. Awarding only to PSUs for the infrastructure is going to be a doomed failure. So we need to get the private players and get some encouraged, dynamic, vibrant startups into this for market savviness and engage for financial support. We all know that electric vehicle infrastructure in the country cannot be copy-pasted from international solutions. So therefore, you know, we need to learn from them, but have our own solutions, because we have challenging conditions like heat, humidity, harmonics. The next last point is, you know, we need to provide strong financial and regulatory support. So road pricing charges and you know, taxi ride hailing, you know, could be only EVs, targeted incentive for buses. And this has been done very well by Norway, and also relevant, you know, tax exemption, customs exemption, already mentioned by Vibhuti, tax breaks, etc. So I'll pause here and later maybe take some questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sireen, for that wonderful insight, and for what you mentioned about EVs and the challenges that the country faces right now. We will now move on to our speaker, Mr. George Kuti, whom we could not, unfortunately, earlier hear properly. So I'm hoping that he would be available right now and his audio will be fine. So Mr. George Kuti, can you hear us now? And would you be speaking to us now, please? I guess yes. Okay, so we will move on to our next panelist, Mr. Sandeep Thantacheri, and he is actually the founder and MD of Navolt, which is credited with India's first solar ferry in Kerala. So over to you, sir, and he would be talking about how solar ferries can be used as a means of sustainable transport in India. Thank you, sir.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, sir. Go ahead. We can see your slides as well. Sure.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I'm very thankful that this forum or this panel decided to invite electric boats in something when we talk of mobility, because it has been our experience, and it is evident from the few policy things which was outlined that there is no discussion or there is no scheme or policy or benefit for electric boats when we talk of electric vehicles from the government side. And that is one of the focus today. I will talk of policy as we go to the second part. But let me first talk about the green shipping itself, which covers broadly both boats as well as large ships. The obvious question, it's a very converted audience, but still, why do we need green shipping? You have set the context from even shipping perspective. The environmental is, of course, a significant part. And we need to understand where the transport contribution of this carbon dioxide and where shipping lies. So, if you take transport, it's total about 15.9%, and which is where the roads and EVs are a dominant one. And shipping, when we say shipping, which includes both seagoing and inland, it's about 1.7%. It's relatively smaller, but still it's a significant number in terms of about 1 gigaton CO2. So, which is why it is an important thing to address it from a policy perspective as well. Now, just to set the context, when we say the objective of green shipping and technologies is to eliminate and reduce the fuel consumption, so which could be diesel or petrol or even dirty fuels like HFO in large ships. So just to give, so you all know that a liter of diesel means about 2.64 kilogram of carbon emission and petrol is 2.3. So even a small boat like here, I put just three different types of boats, 10 passenger boat, 30 passenger boat or 75 passenger boat. These are different sizes of boats. And this is the number, like in the large ferry is about 100 tons of CO2 per year is what is the savings. Just to give you a context of the number. Of course, the other aspects of environment, again, I don't have to go to it. But in water, a very important, which is slightly different from the roads, is the amount of fuel, unburned fuel and dirty bilges that are pumped on water is very high. It's not the case in case of a road, but in water, this is an issue. And when we talk of the broad green shipping, there are now boats and ships. I just want to categorize them in the mind as two different entities. And when we are trying to save fuel, there are two areas to address. One, it is a whole main propulsion, which means what enables a boat or ship to move. That is what we define as propulsion. And then every other energy is called auxiliary, which means whether it's heating, air condition, lighting, and all control system, all other things are auxiliary. So our objective as to reduce fuel, it's not necessary that we completely eliminate, especially in larger vessels, ships, etc. But the objective is to reduce the fuel consumption. So in boats, for example, most of the boats, you can address a main propulsion as well. But there are certain applications, which I will come in the in coming slides, certain applications where it is auxiliary that can be addressed. When it comes to ships, it is mostly the auxiliary that can be addressed. In some special cases, we can address a main propulsion as well. So this whole perspective needs to be understood. So just to give a feel of boats itself. Now, there are a lot of applications possible. And the question is, where we can implement the green technologies, whether it's solar or batteries and all. So the key here is in the kind of application, what is the speed of the boat, the distance it has to be traveled in a day, and the weight of cargo. To be very precise, it's a ratio of weight of cargo to the weight of the boat. So any of these things are increasing, then we move towards the right and the complexity increases, which means the difficulty in making 100% green or 100% by solar electric is difficult as we go to the right side of this slide. So the easiest one are smaller boats, water taxis, leisure boats, the ferry boats. All these three are already done and in service in India and in the rest of the world. Then there are certain applications like the tourism cruise boat, where its air conditioning is also there, some work boats like autonomous collector, etc. And then a huge impact is a fishing boat. I mean, there are about 2.5 lakh fishing boats in India. These are small boats I am referring to, which is not from just environmental perspective, but also in ensuring their livelihood protection, because they spend most of the money they catch on fish on fuel. So that can also be done by moving in towards solar electric. As we move to the larger vessels on the right, or maybe they are faster, it becomes more of a reduction. So it could be a parallel hybrid or just focus only on the auxiliary system. So these are the wide range of possibilities. So, and one additional thing in boats, especially, is the impact on the noise, vibration, and smell of fuel. This is more from a comfort perspective. It may not be very relevant in a big ship, but in boats, it is very relevant for improving the comfort of passengers and the crew, etc. Now, an important aspect which people who understand EVs also know that clearly the cost per kilometer is significantly lower in case of EVs compared to an ICE engine vehicle. But in solar boats, it is even lower because the contribution from solar, which is practically zero OPEX in terms of energy cost, contribution from solar is very high on boats. This is primarily because the boats are slightly oversized for the functional need, because you can do that on water, you cannot do on road, you cannot make the bus wider or the car wider. But in boats, you can do that without increasing the resistance of the boat. So the gap between the OPEX from a diesel or petrol driven boat versus a solar boat is so much different. If you see an example of the same case, a 10 passenger ferry, it's a $10,000 versus $500. If you go to a large ferry, it's about $40,000 versus $600, which is like about 30 lakh rupees per year versus this almost 200, 300 rupees per day, which translates to about 50,000 rupees per year. So it's that 30 lakhs versus 50,000. So it's a huge difference in ferries and all these boats. So wherever it is solar electric and solar contributing a lot, OPEX is clearly proven. And when it comes to TCO, which is a total cost of ownership, which also factor CAPEX. And this is where a significant difference between an electric vehicle on road and a boat comes. In electric vehicles, as you all see that, it is heavily dependent on subsidy. Unless there is a subsidy in place, today the EVs are still not economically viable. Unless, of course, the battery price falls below a certain threshold, which all of them claim it is about $100 per kilowatt hour, which we will get there in a couple of years. So still you need a hand holding, which is what government is doing, which is good. But it's still dependent on that for the short term period, at least. Unlike that, because a significant contribution is coming from sun, that life cycle cost is also very low. So the CAPEX may be some 20 or 30% more, unlike 100% difference in an EV. So 20, 30% more, but the life cycle cost, because significantly low OPEX, it is still electric boats are far more cheaper, especially when they are solar, than a diesel boat in these categories, in large ferry boats and passenger boats, etc. Now, this is just one example of a ferry boat which is plying in Kerala, which is already carried over a million passengers in this last almost 4.5 years of operation. So this is a model that can be replicated across India, and which is already happening, because Kerala government itself is building another 6 more, which we are doing, and many other projects are happening within Kerala and rest of India for taking the public transport and even leisure boats shifting to solar, because it's clearly proven that it is more economical. So there is no doubt about it. And I already mentioned about the CAPEX, OPEX, etc. So this is just this perspective. This is the boat, both the kind of boats operating side by side in Vaikyam. And this is, it's a pure solar electric boat. There is no fuel on this boat. And that's how this is. I'll go further. When it comes to large ships, for example, these container vessels, which we are doing the work for one of our clients, here, the propulsion, you can forget it, because it's a huge ship. Even the energy required from genset, which is auxiliary, the contribution is not large from the volume of oil consumed per day. Let's say 100 tons per day is oil consumption, fuel consumption. But the investment is economical, and that is a key. So it enables a reduction. So here it is a system without battery, just like you talk about rooftop and all with grid tie system, something similar, but on ships it's a totally different kind of inverters, because you don't have it's what you call as a floating neutral. So there's no neutral on ship. So it's a slightly different inverters. It's not the same. So here also there's a break even is less than 4-5 years, and the sensitivity, even if you take a very relatively lower fuel price also, it's a very economic decision to implement these to reduce your consumption. That thing can be done in almost all the large ships. And then there are certain vessels which cannot be done for containers and few other vessels, but many other bulk carriers, oil tankers, etc., you can do this wind propulsion. And this can contribute almost 20 to 30% of the propulsion, which is, so large ships, wind is what matters. And it's not the solar. Solar will help in reduction, but if you have to significantly do that, wind is a way forward. And that is exactly what a lot of technologies has come into play. Now, just to give a perspective of the boat itself, it has taken big time in the world, especially in Europe. So the estimations are something like this, based on the market is planned to hit about 2023. It's about 14.3 billion. This is boating sector. It's not the large ships. I'm saying the e-boats. So here I come to the policy, and this is where I have a serious problem with the government policy machinery, which includes Niti Aayog, Department of Heavy Industry, and various other bodies. They are totally ignoring electric boats and the boating sector itself, which is why even in FAME 1 and FAME 2, there is no mention of electric boats. So this discrimination has to end. It has to give the same level of support which is given to the road, has to be given to water as well, so that the adoption is faster. That is objective of FAME. You have a faster adoption. So you do a hand-holding in the early stage, and that is only what we expect for the next 3 years, 5 years. Put an amount. When it comes to putting amount, they say when it comes to addressing electric boats, it is mentioned that it's a small sector. When it comes to increasing for EV, they will say, oh no, we don't have budget to have a large impact. So it's a convenient way of just shifting to avoid, because it's just ignorance. I call it that people sitting in Delhi have no clue what water transport is, because they have to step out and see what is happening in Bengal, Kerala, Goa, Maharashtra, etc., to see how this works. And then financing. This is a crucial element why automobile sector picked up, because you can treat the vehicle itself as a primary collateral. The banks will give financing. Nowadays, it's 90% finance. In a boat, nobody will finance you. You still need a secondary collateral, which is unfortunate. But it's also to do with the fact that the boats are still very fragmented industry, as well as the rules are different in each state. So even the second hand market is not very strong. That is also why the financing is not very strong. Unless you have uniform rules across India, this is an issue, this is a challenge. So this has to be supported to change. And then there are these strange things which even the government department, this is a tender from Cochin Shipyard. You are talking of a project which is maybe 50 crore, 100 crore, the boats you had to supply, which takes 1-2 years. You will get payment 80% after you deliver, and then 20% after a few months after commissioning. So, and the important thing is the manufacturer of these boats are not large centralized players like big cars like Mahindra, Tata, which where the financing is there in place. That is not the case. Most of the boat builders are MSMEs. Who struggle for financing. As we all know, MSME financing is the biggest challenge. And they come up with these conditions which just support the either import of these systems. And then you have, again, differential payment terms for foreign players, which again is another issue which I've raised in multiple forums. There is the GST support which is provided for electric vehicles. There is a differential GST between EVs versus other vehicle. In boats, that is not the case. There must be some difference between an e-boat and other boats. And lastly, I want to say electric boats are big time in Europe, because there is a grant and technology development happening. So most of the projects in EU are grant funded by EU grants. There's nothing of that sort in India. So you will never have the frontier technologies being implemented. So today, even though we have a technology for hydrogen fuel cell implementation, we cannot do, because there is no support system on the hydrogen supply side. Economics is not working. So unless there is a hand-holding happening, this will not work. Thankfully for the fishing boat, Shell Foundation came up for support, and hence we are doing it. But this is something which has to be thought through. Yeah, this is all from a technology side, and I hope this will all lead to finally the electric boats also being transformed the way some of these companies like Tesla has done on roads. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sandit. And that was really insightful. We're speaking about solar, we're speaking about the solar ferry and the challenges involved in terms of financing and in terms of the policy. So, hoping that in the year to come, things will improve for the better, and we will be able to do as well as people abroad. So all the presentations, I request all the panelists to please share their presentations, and we will give you the rights. And we will now move to our next panelist, Mr. George Kutty. So we look forward to hearing from you. So over to you, sir.
Mr. George Kutty's audio is still not working for whatever reason, Sapna, may I suggest that if you could share the presentation with us, and we'll share it with the journalists. And I'm sure he's got, I know that Mr. George Kutty has done very interesting work that will interest a lot of journalists. So, and they will be able to get in touch with him directly. So if the audio is not working, well, I'm sorry about that. We apologize to Mr. George Kutty and to all participants, but I think that's the best way out. And perhaps now move to the questions. I already see some questions in the Q&A section.
It's there in
and
the Q&A.
Before you start the questions, may I just point out to all participants that we have already shared the link for the story grants. So to all journalist participants, you'll have to hurry up and put in your story grant applications because the deadline is tomorrow. Back to you, Sapna.
Sure. So we will now move on to the questions. And there are a few questions. So the first is from Shubhangini Dubey. And she says, where do common citizens, where will they have to go to get all the information regarding rooftops, rooftop solar panel subsidies? So here, Shubhangini, I think we, Joydeep, we are talking about EVs, right? So we're not talking specifically about rooftop solar. So do we address this question to our panelists or
maybe
do
they answer, answer it yourself very, very briefly?
Okay. So I think regarding rooftop solar panel subsidies, Shubhangini, the best place for you would be to visit the MNRE website, which is the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. I think that is the best place which gives you information regarding not just rooftop solar, but also talks about the subsidies involved. And you can also email me if you want more details. I can help you out with that. The other one is
Sapna. Sorry, I've also responded in the Q&A chat box. So the other source would be renewable energy development agencies, which are the for each state they have specific renewable energy departments, and they are responsible for solar rooftop uptake. They would most likely have these policies laid out at state level. And there are few think tanks and CSOs which have already kind of compiled these, which includes the likes of Mercom, Bridge to India. So that could be another platform to get hold of this kind of an information.
So Shubhangini, I hope that answers your query, but you can still get in touch with any of us if you need further details. The other is from Safina Wani, which says, what is the status in terms of EV vehicles in Srinagar? She says, now for now, we only have 20 EV buses for public transport facility in Srinagar. So any of our panelists who would like to answer that question, please. Would want to take up this particular question? Dr. Shalini, Vibhuti, Sandit, Mr. George Kutty.
Unfortunately, Sapna, I don't have the state-specific development numbers that But we are seeing, as Ms. Shalini also did mention, that there are 9 to 10 states which are more active and have come up with good policies to kind of promote adoption of electric vehicles. Definitely, Srinagar isn't part of those top 9 or 10 states which are kind of leaders or, and you know, who are promoting this development. But I won't have that level of information for Srinagar specifically.
Yeah, I'm afraid I don't see Srinagar in that list of 9 states which have been very aggressive in its EV policies and incentives.
Well, that makes it a story idea, by the way. Here's my suggestion to the questioner. Do a story on why it's not so.
So, Jyoti, do we move to the next question?
Oh, sure.
Yeah. So the next question is from Shubhangini Dubey, which says that some innovations have been done by private mechanical engineers across the states of Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra in electric vehicles. Will they be incentivized or will they be able to patent their innovation? So she's talking about private mechanical engineers across these two states who have made some innovations in the EV sector. So will they be able to patent the innovation is what she wants to know.
I'm aware, so this is Shalini here, and I'm aware of a lot of patents coming out in the EV space, whether it is the integrated software or it is the simulation software for bus fleet management and forecasting. And we all know that there is enough and more happening in battery swapping technology. And we are working very closely as a charge point operator with several of these technologists from different space that I just talked about. So yes, there is a mechanism, and you need to follow the same patent process. And in a nutshell, yes, and there is incentive for it. There is a patent strategy for it and a methodology, but there are more and more coming out in the ecosystem that we work with.
Sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Shalini, for answering the query. I move on to the next query now, which is from Kapil Tiwari, which says that, what is the strategy that electric vehicle companies in India should make to reach their goals? What is the strategy they need to adapt to reach their goals? Any of our panelists would like to take up that query, please?
I can answer for boards, but he has asked electric vehicles.
EV companies.
So, but for boards, it would be interesting to know.
I can tell about. See, the approach we take for the boards, especially, is to go focus on applications where the economics work, which means, as you know, in India. Finally, people will buy a product because it is economical and not because it's green. You will focus on so that is one reason why public transport was a natural choice, because asset is being heavily utilized. That is also the fact why Uber works. The asset utilization is high. So ferry boats is a good start. The next one is these fishing boats. So there is a natural step of following applications where the economics work. I'm sure the same is applied for EVs per se. So which means the vehicles which has used more, which is taxis, which is what Ola Electric is all about. So go for things which are heavily utilized, and then buses and those applications where the vehicle itself is. private transport is probably the last thing which will work economically, but there's no harm in trying, but I am just saying the sequence and preference.
Thank you, Mr. Sandeep. And I move on to the next question, which is from Pramotesh Sahu, which says, what can be the solution for uniformity in charging and the battery types? So, Dr. Shalini or Vibhuti?
Yeah, this is a very, very good question, because, you know, the interoperability is a big question mark today. So what are the solution. So now, whether we are, following the CCS or the CHAdeMO from the charger perspective and from the battery swapping perspective, if the battery sizes are going to be very different, is there an interface that we can create for the battery swapping station? And yes, that's exactly what I was talking about. The new patents are coming out in that technology as well, where they are able to broadly categorize in two or three and offer the interoperability. So standardization is required, and in two-wheelers and three-wheelers, it's going to be easier. And that's why battery swapping is not going to be viable for car manufacturers, because that's the differentiation that they create. But even if we are able to do it for two-wheeler and three-wheelers, or even e-rickshaws, we are good.
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Shalini. The next question is from, one second. Next question is from Gurvinder Singh, which says, do you agree that governments are running electric buses or promoting e-rickshaws, but there are not enough charging points in the cities? I think, Dr. Shalini, you did mention something about this in your presentation, in your talk.
Sorry, can you repeat the question, please?
There's, do you agree that governments are running electric buses or promoting e-rickshaws, but there are not enough charging points in the cities?
Yeah, and I think that's again a challenge and a chicken and egg story, that wherever they are also mandating charging infrastructure, it is underutilized. And if it is underutilized, the economic viability will always be a question. And that's why I think a little bit of more consultation, a little bit of more engagement with various ecosystem partners. And I keep re-emphasizing the value of ecosystem partners, which is becoming so prominent in EV that competitors are also getting into alliance partnerships for a unified solution. So that if there is a bus depot where the bus charging happens at night, during the day, it could be, doing battery swapping. And if, there is a flexibility allowed there, we must use, how can we optimize the use of the infrastructure that we are creating? Because the uptake today will not make the economics viable. So yes, there is a challenge today, but it can be bridged by interoperability, sharing, flexibility, getting all ecosystem partners together.
Sure. Thanks, Dr. Shali and Gurvinder. I hope your question has been answered. I move on to the next query, which is by Ishan Kukreti, which says, where is the world in terms of battery material and the rare earth minerals? Will we be able to meet the projected demand, or will there be a peak oil type of situation? Who would like to answer that?
This is like a crystal grazing question, I think. I wish we have the crystal ball. It's a million-dollar question. We all struggle with it. I'm not sure we have an expert on battery or earth sciences on the panel, but I wish to get the answer, and it's like crystal grazing.
I will just quickly respond to, based on, again, I'm not an expert, so with very limited knowledge, but I do read few papers, and there was this very interesting discussion by Niti Aayog just 2 days back, specifically on the lithium-ion battery raw material. So while there is a lot of speculation that, India will have to depend largely on imports, but that's a myth. And lithium ion is a very small component of the materials that is required to build. So there is other raw materials like nickel, cobalt, which India has. So clearly, if we go ahead with manufacturing or, large lithium ion batteries, that India will again, switch from one kind of dependency to the other, which is not the case. So that's the key takeaways from that article, which I'm sharing now. But yeah, best to talk with those experts and, get more kind of knowledge for exactly on how the situation is. But that's what my understanding was after reading that article, that that's not the case.
Thanks. I add one point also on this.
Sure. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, so one, just to give a context, so when we are talking lithium, when we are saying the shift in dependence from oil to lithium, just to give a context, if you are assuming, let's the example of ferry boat I just mentioned, so the battery what we import, let's say, is about 25 lakh, it saves every year the fuel equivalent of 25 lakhs. So the cost of whatever the value we are importing, if in terms of lithium, the fuel saving in terms of crude oil transition is 30 times if you see the whole life cycle. So that perspective has to be kept in mind.
Yeah, I think that's a very, very critical point. So there is one upfront cost versus, the cost over the life cycle. And clearly there are huge advantages in terms of, shifting to clean mobility, even there is reliance on some developed imports, which again, as I said, we really need to dig deeper into understanding whether that's the case or not. And if India can definitely develop its own, battery manufacturing again in India as well.
Sure. Thanks, Dr. Shalini. Thanks, Sandeep. Thanks, Vibhuti, for stepping in and answering the queries. And there's one from Monica Gulati, which says, what about the cost-effective vehicles for metropolitan areas of our country? I don't understand cost-effective vehicles.
Yeah, exactly. So, the whole reason why these are being subsidized is that it's quite expensive compared to your conventional vehicles. But we have seen, the battery cost going down even with more technology innovations and economies of scale. We are seeing the prices of even EVs dropping. So I think we haven't yet hit that kind of a, breakthrough where the costs are kind of reflective the prices are reflective of the cost. So that's why there's huge support coming from the government to begin with. But that's always the case with any new technology. So even when India started its renewable energy adoption, like even just 10 years back, there were huge schemes, huge government support. And now renewables are competitive on their own without any government support. So similarly, we do expect that kind of a similar kind of a behavior even in electric vehicles and batteries in a few years down the line. And that clearly will, shift more and more people because currently what happened like a few years back, it was more of a statement that, people who can afford such expensive electric vehicles, I'm talking about private, were only buying that. But clearly, with price points coming in the range where a normal people can also buy electric vehicles, we are seeing that increasingly. And definitely, as more and more people shift, that will lead to a reduction in pollution in the cities. And that's why, especially the Delhi government, you know, with the rising air pollution problem, has been promoting deployment or adoption of electric vehicles very, very aggressively.
Sure. Thanks, Vibhuti, for taking that question. And I think the last question for this session, we have something very interesting that says, I think it's for all the panelists. It says, dear all, do we have any mention in our school education in any state where children are given specific knowledge about clean mobility? That's interesting.
I would just say that I don't think so that's the case. Definitely a lot of schools are talking about the issue of air pollution. I have personally interacted with few students and organized workshop a year back before this pandemic during Diwali time when the issue of air pollution, you know, had caused a lot of havoc and the schools were being closed because of the rising air pollution problems, and that was becoming a kind of a permanent feature year on year, and the schools were struggling. They had not switched or they have not used virtual way of teaching by that time. It's only the pandemic which led schools to shift to virtual teaching. So there was a lot of discussion, and students were very, very engaged, were very much aware about what were the various factors causing and what India needs to do. But the discussion was more in terms of, you know, the issue of stubble burning, the issue to some extent on the transport, the issue on industries, but not specifically discussion on clean mobility, but more on the other big factors that were driving the issue of air pollution. And I don't know if that discussion was limited to places like Delhi NCR and the surrounding areas where the issue of pollution is more, because down south, I don't think so. They do face the issue of pollution to that extent because clearly the AQI levels are much, much more favorable. So I don't know if that's the case across India.
Thanks so much, Vibhuti. Joydeep, I have a request from Torb saying we can ask Mr. George Kutty to speak again. We can just request him. Probably the issue has been set right.
Yeah, go ahead.
Should be. So, Mr. George Kutty, sir, can you speak now? Can you? I guess the issue has been resolved. I think we'll be able to hear you now. So could you try now? I think we can hear you now. You can go ahead.
He just said that he's able to speak.
He said that, okay.
Yes.
I also told him to answer a question or two so we could kind of, check on the audio and then we could ask him to speak again. But I don't know what the issue is.
Okay, let me check with him again.
Please. There is a question from it says anonymous attendee, which says, how green are the green vehicles given that electricity is a byproduct of fossil fuel burning? How many charging points are fed by renewable sources of energy in India? Do we have any statistics? This is a question we have from another attendee. Dr. Shalini.
Yeah, so I don't have the data, but I know that this is a very, very big concern and has been addressed by several countries by having rooftop canopies, solar canopies at charging stations. but there are evidences and examples of rooftop canopies in India as well. And I know of many companies who are doing it, but yes, it is still a concern. And it's primarily because of the economics, which needs to become more viable. And I think one of the ways we can make it viable is like some of the examples that we spoke about. If we can do the day charging and we have ample sun where we don't really need storage and we can have the energy DC to DC, we actually bring down the cost of total ownership and implementation because the cost essentially goes up because of storage. And there needs to be more such ventures and more such examples. And there needs to be some financial incentives to be able to. And I don't see them coming as a comprehensive financial instrument plan in the state government policies that I have read.
Can I also add on this?
Go ahead, Sandeep. I'll add later. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so now coming to the grid mix, it's a very valid question on how clean renewable vehicles are or EVs are. It's dependent on the grid mix itself. In India, it's almost 35%+ is from renewable, which includes hydro. So some may say hydro is not exactly green, but that is at least the case in India. And some states have higher grid mix. For example, in Kerala, it's closer to 50. So that is one point. So it's not 100%. So it's a reduction for sure by shifting to electric vehicles, as long as we have solar and other renewable energy mix in the grid. That's one point. And when we are comparing, when we keep telling about renewable energy having the production itself having the pollution, that what we call as the well to tank. So when the fuel also, when we talk of diesel, it's not only the post tank to power, which is the pollution. You also have the well to tank, which means there's so much pollution to bring it to your tank. So that if you add that perspective, even the production of solar panels and batteries, etc., are very, very low. So it's a 1 year for when you compare the pollution of the whole manufacturing of a solar panels and battery compared to the next 25, 30 years when it will save you electricity and reduce the carbon emission. So that is just to give a perspective on the numbers.
And just one last point, that is the whole reason, you know, I was talking about rooftop solar plus storage should be the way going forward, primarily to reduce reliance on, charging being done through conventional coal-fired power generation. And as Dr. Shalini clearly mentioned, we don't have the right policies and the financial incentives in place, which is the kind of the need of the hour. And more and more states should think on these lines and promote, mechanisms through which rooftop solar plus the charging can be promoted together in conjunction.
So do we have, thank you so much to all our panelists for answering all the queries so well. Do we have time for one more question, which has come in from Ishan Kukreti again, which speaks about US versus India and government subsidies. It says that in the US, it was a mix of government subsidies and regulations that led to EVs being picked up and players like Tesla coming up. So do we have a similar mix here in India and would we benefit from this? Also goes on to add that maybe a stipulation that a specific percentage of production by automobile companies to be EVs or a certain percentage of public transport fleet to be EV.
So, I would say yes, India is also having the mix of subsidies as well as the right regulations. But again, that is more state specific. There are some states that are coming up with more policies and regulations. But on the other hand, saying that, you know, certain percentage of the company should produce these many vehicles. So unless there is a demand, you know, why would they create an inventory? So I think the best is a demand push rather than a supply push in this case. So there has to be enough infrastructure created for charging, enough incentives be creating for EVs, and that would push more and more automobile companies to, you know, increase their fleet of electric vehicles. That's my 2 cents on this.
I just want to mention here once again that EVs have subsidy and support to some extent. It can be better. Electric boats have none.
I think that's a point very well made, and thanks for raising it, because I also did not know as much, but thank you.
Sure. So thank you, everybody, and thank you all our panelists, and thanks to all the participants as well, and thank you for raising all those very interesting questions. I think we will just wind up now, and it's been a very interesting session on clean mobility. There are so many issues which can still be discussed, I guess, but I guess time is also a constraint. A recording of the webinar will be available on our website. You know, it's there on the, in the chat box. We'll send you a follow-up mail also with a link. And also, please be aware of the fact that tomorrow is the last date for sending in your story ideas for the grant. So please be prepared. I think a lot of story ideas would have come up after today's enlightening session. So thank you, everyone, and hopefully we will look forward. We will have another session soon, and we will also have you on board. So thank you very much. Joydeep, would you like to add something?
No, just to repeat that request to all panelists who had presentations to share them quickly, because I know that all journalists will start asking us for them within the next 2 minutes. So please do mail them to us as soon as we can share. Thanks a lot, everybody. Bye.
Bye. Thank you so much.
Yeah, given the situation.
Yes, stay safe.
Yeah, stay safe. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.